Remember that the chapter is titled A Vision for You. You know, there's sort of a, it's not a recent movement either. It may have been around AA years before I ever came in. But there's a group of people who say, you know, in the chapter of Vision for You, it says, obviously you can't transmit something you haven't got. And how are you going to teach somebody the steps if you don't know the steps? Being the idea that the chapter of Vision for You is based solely on the story of Bill Wilson standing outside of a bar, and his 6 months of sobriety are over. He's going to step in. He says, I'm going to step into that bar and have a few drinks. That's what he says. And his sanity returns, and he steps over to this phone booth, and there's some numbers on there about the church directory, and he makes some phone calls and ends up coming across Dr. Bob, and AA is born. So it says it's a vision for you, not a vision for Bill. And the vision being that, see, there's a difference between people who stay sober in Alcoholics Anonymous and people who don't stay sober and go out and relapse. And the difference is that they teach the 12 steps to other people. And, you know, I've ever since I got sober, too, it's almost like a group of people, you know, like there's a group of people in my life that at one time or another, it's always the end of the world to them, you know, it's always disaster around the corner. And then there's a group of people that, you know, they're always happy and always, you know, if the world does end tomorrow, what the hell with it, you know. And this group of people in Alcoholics Anonymous is the group of people that says, you know, you're dealing with other people's lives. If you don't know what you're doing, you need to not sponsor people. But what they're not thinking about is that it's your sobriety. And the 12 steps and the idea of the 12 steps are very simple. I say to some of the sponsees that I take through the steps, I say, look, you're a 35, 45-year-old man here, woman. You are a 40-year-old man, and you can't just take those 40 years and throw them out the window like they did in existence and say you've got 2 weeks of sobriety, and the last 40 years count for absolutely nothing. You're a moron. You know nothing. How can you say that to somebody? You know, the simplicity of the 12 steps is the whole idea is that you have been a selfish, self-centered person, and it's not an indictment of you. It's a simple matter of saying that I never made a conscious decision to be a selfish person. I was that way because I never learned how to invert that. I never learned that was a problem. I mean, I had arguments. I remember my girlfriends or my mother saying something like that to me in some kind of spiteful argument that we were having. They said, you're a selfish person. And I go, yeah, whatever, you know. But until I came here, did I say, you know what, I think they're right. But I never sat down and said, I have a decision to make here. I'm going to be a selfish person who thinks nothing of other people, or I'm going to be a selfless person who lives a life of sacrifice for others. And that, you know, there's these two options here, and I never weighed those options before. I never even knew it was a problem until I came into here. But the basic idea of the recovery program is that the alcoholics, by nature, not, you know, just it's an instinctual thing, as the 12 and 12 puts it. It's the instinct for self-preservation that has me so afraid for myself that I just don't have time to think of doing things for other people with nothing in return, with the thought of no gain or any return rewards or whatsoever, you know. But that's the idea of the 12 steps. It's the whole idea is that I clear away what's blocking me from being a selfless person through the process that we have. And this chapter of Vision for You is all about that. It's all about having, it says, you know, get your house in order and see to it that your relationship with God is right. And anyway, we're going to read that paragraph or two, whatever it is in the end there. That are, you know, they read it in a lot of meetings. They call it, this is a vision for you. It's that last couple of paragraphs in this chapter here. But there's a couple of other good things in here too, like the idea that this book is your sponsor. This book is your guide through the steps is right here in these pages. So we're going to read this couple of pages. I'll give a little lead afterwards. And remember that this chapter is a vision for you. And the vision for you is that you can help people through the 12 steps. And the idea that I was trying to dispel is that, you know, so many people say, well, you know, number one, it's sort of a pass, too, to some people. Because who wants to do that hard work? I didn't. When I came into AA, I never said, oh, that's what I want to do. I want to run out and start sponsoring. I didn't. I didn't do it till my sponsor said, you're either going to do it, or that's all there is to it. You're going to do it, and or you're going to drink, one of the two. That, he didn't say that, but I felt that. We're on 161 in the middle of the page there, but Life Among Alcoholics Anonymous. We got like three and a half pages, whatever it is. But Life Among Alcoholics Anonymous is more than attending gatherings and visiting hospitals, cleaning up old scrapes, helping to settle family differences, explaining the disinherited son to his irate parents, lending money and securing jobs for each other when justified. These are everyday occurrences. No one is too discredited or has sunk too low to be welcomed cordially if he means business. That's a if he means business. That's a sort of a criteria there, isn't it? Because how many people do you see come into AA and mean business? Most of the people I see just come in here, sit down, don't say nothing, don't do nothing, and get up and walk out. That's their effort at saving their life. That's what I like to say. I say, you know what? My effort is saving my life. It says we grasp this program with all the desperation, the drowning man. That's from the 12 and 12, that the drowning grasp at a life preserver. And here I sit in an AA meeting. They go, who wants to sponsor somebody? And I go, me. And that's like it. That's all. That's my attempt at saving my own life. My desperation at grasping a life preserver is to raise my hand in a meeting. But anyway, I'll get to that later. There's a certain things that you can do that attract people to you, and certain things that you can do that repel people away from you. People say, I don't want what that guy's got, when you're out in the parking lot screaming at people. Or if you're doing the 12 steps and living a life of sacrifice, people are drawn to you, and they say, hey, will you help me? No one is too discredited or has sunk too low to be welcomed cordially if he means business. Social distinctions, petty rivalries, and jealousies are laughed out of countenance. Being wrecked in the same vessel, being restored and united under one God, with hearts and minds attuned to the welfare of others, the things which matter so much to some people no longer signify much to them. How could they? Under only slightly different conditions, the same thing is taking place in many eastern cities. In one of these, there's a well-known hospital for the treatment of alcohol and drug addiction. That's New York, I believe, with Bill Wilson there. 6 years ago, one of our number, which is Bill, was a patient there. Many of us have felt for the first time the presence and power of God within its walls. And that's what Bill writes in his story, that for the first time he felt the presence of God, and like some kind of great wind blew through him, right through his body and everything. But we are greatly indebted to the doctor in attendance there. That would be that Silkworth guy up in the front of the book there, the doctor's opinion. For he, although it might prejudice his own work, has told us of his belief in ours. Every few days the doctor suggests our approach to one of his patients. Understanding our work, he can do this with an eye on selecting those who are willing and able to recover on a spiritual basis. You see how he's separating right there? He's saying that with an eye for this, he's going to be able to select those who are willing and able to recover. Basically meaning some people aren't ready. And he can see the ones that aren't ready. They just, you know, come in for three hots and a cot for a couple of weeks and back out to the grind. Many of us former patients go there to help. Then in this eastern city there are informal meetings such as we have described to you, where you may now see scores of members. There are the same fast friendships, there are the same helpfulness to one another as you find among our Western friends, which would be Akron and Cleveland. There's a good, because this is like 1939, remember this, it was only like three AA meetings. And maybe a few little, you know, little ones that sprung outwards in 39. There's a good bit of travel between East and West, and we foresee a great increase in this helpful interchange. Someday we hope that every alcoholic who journeys will find a fellowship of Alcoholics Anonymous at his destination. To some extent, this is already true. Some of us are salesmen and go about. Little clusters of twos and threes and fives of us have sprung up in other communities. Through contact with our two larger centers, those of us who travel drop in as often as we can. This practice enables us to lend a hand, at the same time avoiding certain alluring distractions of the road about which any traveling man can inform you. Thus we grow, and so can you. Though you be but one man with this book in your hand, we believe and hope it contains all you will need to begin. You see where this... Now, I don't recommend that you don't have a sponsor and just use this book as a guide, because in my own experience, I didn't understand what half of this stuff was talking about. I needed somebody to... Actually, it's been years. I'd gone over and over and over this stuff for a number of years before I fully understand what it means. But the basic idea is fairly simple and straightforward. The selfishness and self-centeredness being the root of our troubles, and that sacrifice, service and sacrifice for others is the solution. But he says here, though you be but one man with this book in your hand, we believe and hope it contains all you will need to begin. We know what you're thinking. You are saying that you're saying to yourself, I'm jittery and alone, I couldn't do that. But you can. You forget that you have just now tapped a source of power much greater than yourself. To duplicate with such backing what we have accomplished is only a matter of willingness, patience, and labor. So, for you to learn the 12 steps and to live them in your life, and then to go out and teach these 12 steps to others, is only a matter of willingness, patience, and labor. If you're trying to get 2 years before you start sponsoring people, guess what? You might not make it. Because if sponsorship of others is your source of sobriety, and you're not doing what it is that is the source of sobriety, and then that when everybody falls by the wayside, they go, oh, did you hear about so-and-so? Yeah, that was sad, you know. We know of an AA member who was living in a large community. He had lived there but a few weeks when he found that the place probably contained more alcoholics per square mile than any city in the country. This was only a few days ago at this writing, 1939. The authorities were much concerned. He got in touch with a prominent psychiatrist who had undertaken certain responsibilities for the mental health of the community. The doctor proved to be able to be able and exceedingly anxious to adopt any workable method of handling the situation. So he inquired, what did our friend have on the ball? Our friend proceeded to tell him, and with such good effect that the doctor agreed to a test among his patients and certain other alcoholics from a clinic which he attends. Arrangements were also made with the chief psychiatrist of a large public hospital to select still others from the stream of misery which flows through that institution. So our fellow worker will soon have friends galore. Some of them may sink and perhaps never get up, but if our experience is a criterion, more than half of those, that's 50%, which is what it states in the front of this book in the forward to the second edition, I believe it is. More than half of those approach will become fellow of Alcoholics Anonymous. When a few men in this city have found themselves and have discovered the joy of helping others to face life again, there will be no stopping until everyone in that town has had his opportunity to recover, if he can and will. And this is the part where you're always reading in the meetings here, these last few paragraphs here. Still you may say, but I will not have the benefit of contact with you who wrote this book. We cannot be sure. God will determine that. So you must remember that your real reliance is always upon Him. He will show you how to create the fellowship you crave. You know, that's one of the things my sponsor used to always say to me. I'd go to my sponsor sometimes and go, man, those meetings are terrible. All those people do is complain about their problems and just pissing and moaning and crying and whining. I can't stand it anymore. And he says, well, what are you doing about it? Well, why don't you do something? If you want a fellowship where we read the book and talk about the 12 steps and recovery and spirituality and God and hope, then why don't you do something about it and become the person who instigates that, other than the guy who comes crying to me all the time about this crap. He says, God will show you how to create the fellowship you crave. Our book is meant to be suggestive only. We realize we know only a little. God will constantly disclose more to you and us, and to us. Ask Him in your morning meditation what you can do. That's back in the 11th step there, where it says, upon awakening, let us think about the 24 hours ahead. Ask him in the morning meditation what you can do each day for the man who is still sick. The answers will come if your own house is in order. But obviously you cannot transmit something you haven't got. See to it that your relationship with Him is right, and great events will come to pass for you and countless others. This is the great fact for us. Abandon yourself to God as you understand God. Admit your faults to Him and your fellows. Clear away the wreckage of your past, give freely of what you find, and join us. We shall be with you in the fellowship of the Spirit, and you will surely meet some of us as you trudge the road of happy destiny. May God bless you and keep you until then. We'll read Dr. Bob's Nightmare, start Dr. Bob's Nightmare next month, or next week, I guess it is, next Thursday. But there's a lot in there, you know, where he says, obviously you cannot transmit something you haven't got.